Recording. Send. Button. Speech off.
Hello, listeners. In this audio clip, we will take forward the discussion on the recently concluded meeting of the Committee on Rights of Persons with Disabilities in Geneva. You will recall that before the creation of this channel, I had recorded an audio clip on the CRPD meeting, which went viral, and I had recorded that audio clipping based on a partial listening of the proceedings of the meeting, which I had mentioned in that clip itself. Now, a few days back, a friend of ours had forwarded to me an audio clip containing a statement by a non-official member of the official delegation of the Government of India to the CRPD meeting. And he requested me, that friend requested me, and some others also requested me to explain in simple language as to what the non-official member, Mr. Santosh Shungta, had said, and then he had also, they had also requested me to give my own view on the issues that he spoke on. I must reiterate what I had stated in my earlier audio clip on this subject, that the Committee on the Rights of Persons with Disabilities is an international committee which was constituted under the provisions of the United Nations Convention on the Rights of Persons with Disabilities, to which India is a state party. Now, in the course of the deliberation, and I think you are aware that every state party is under an obligation to submit what is called a country report containing details of the steps that the concerned state party has taken to implement the provisions of this convention in their respective countries. And as a part of that stipulation, the Government of India had submitted its initial country report in 2015, which came up for discussion and deliberation in the committee very recently in the course of its meeting in Geneva, where the committee has also given its concluding observations after listening to the official delegation and after discussing with the official delegations. And I had, as I had stated in my earlier audio clip, that the committee in its concluding observations listed out some of the positive aspects of what India has done, but at the same time, it has also listed out quite a lot of areas of concern, which included use of terminology and, absence of disability as a prohibited ground of discrimination under Article 15 of the Constitution, and also lack of adequate consultation with the primary stakeholders, and a host of other areas. Now, Mr. Santosh Shungta has been a part of the official delegation. He's a non-official member of the official delegation. He's a senior advocate, himself blind, and is an activist. So I would first try to give you the sum and substance of what he had stated, and then move on to give my own observations or my own opinion on what he had stated. Now, with regard to the use of terminology, Mr. Santosh Roongta stated that he appreciated the concern of the committee, since he also happens to be an activist, but he justified this terminology and taking forward the defense put forth by the Secretary Department of Empowerment of Persons with Disabilities, Government of India. He stated that we must look at the intent and the context behind the use of this terminology, Divyang. Because I must here I must mention that the committee had expressed concern, and they still are concerned about the use of terminology such as Divyang, mentally ill, etc., etc. Now, he said that the government at the highest level has the best of intentions, and which is why there's nothing wrong in the use of this word Divyang, which actually literally translates into persons with divine limbs or divine organs, Divyangjan. And then he also stated that the context must also be looked at. And he said that earlier on, the word disability was translated in Hindi as nishakt, meaning weak. And therefore, the government at the highest level recognized the abilities of persons with disabilities and coined this word Divyangjan. Now, this means that what he was actually trying to say, though he didn't use those words, I am using, that they were lifted up from a subhuman state to a superhuman state. Anyway, I'll comment on that later. That's my comment. Now, as far as the context of this, and thirdly, he said that at the highest level, and the secretary of the department said that actually it translates into persons with extraordinary abilities or divine abilities, but the literal translation is persons with divine limbs or divine organs. Secondly, Mr. Roongta says that yes, Article 15 does not include disability as a prohibited ground of discrimination. I mean, Article 15 has four clauses, and the first clause says no citizen shall be discriminated against on ground of religion, race, place of birth, gender, like that. So their disability is not included. So he said that that doesn't really matter so much. That's what he meant. He said that initially he also felt as an activist that disability should have been included as a prohibited ground of discrimination. But later when he studied the issue in greater depth, he found that it doesn't really so much matter, because Article 14 of the Constitution guarantees equality before the law and equal protection of the law to all citizens, and therefore persons with disabilities are covered there. And he further went on to say that the context or the backdrop of Article 15 was essentially to ensure access, so that people were not deprived of access to places of worship like temples or to wells for drawing water. So it was actually, according to him, a safeguard against denial of access on the ground of religion, race, caste, gender, like that. But the fact of the matter, however, is that I will come to it when I give my comment. And the third thing he said was that no, the government did consult or did undertake widespread consultations when the R.P.D. Act, Rights of Persons with Disabilities Act, was in the making. And in that context, he said that even his organization significantly contributed to the drafting process of the Rights of Persons with Disabilities Act 2016. Now let me give you my views. First, let me take up this issue of terminology. Yes, I do agree that the intent of the government is very good. And the Prime Minister and the Government of India has done path-breaking work in many areas. There's absolutely no denying the fact that it has, and I'm particularly impressed with the kind of work, with the patriotism which is getting promoted, with the dilution of Article 370 and abolition of triple talaq and things like that. But I do not endorse the use of the word Divyangjan. While the intent is good, the context invites comments. Now, I do not buy this argument that Nishakt only means physically weak. Nishakt actually means disempowered. So you can be disempowered on account of poverty. You can be disempowered on various counts. And therefore, what I feel is that you don't have to, you glorify persons with disabilities, you glorify their abilities, you glorify their contribution, you glorify their merit, you glorify their abilities, but you don't have to glorify impairment. There is nothing to glorify or condemn impairment. Impairment is a state of fact. It is a matter of fact. So why not state a fact as a fact like the UN Convention does? It says United Nations Convention on the Rights of Persons with Disabilities. It doesn't say United Nations Convention on the Rights of Persons with Divine Abilities or Divine Organs or Divine Limbs. Now, I feel that, and if you say that you are lifting somebody, and actually this is equal to what he is actually trying to say, is that earlier they were weak, now they have been super strong. So I would interpret it like it is analogous to saying, earlier you were subhuman, now you are superhuman. We are neither subhuman nor superhuman. We are as human as anyone else, and that needs to be recognized. Now, let's see how. So persons with disabilities would have been a better, Vikalangjan in Hindi would have been a better word. More, it's a statement of facts and nothing to be ashamed of it. Now, what does the word Divyangjan mean? Divya in Hindi means divine. Ang in Hindi means limb or organ. So you are saying that a person with disabilities is a person with divine limbs. Now take an example. I happen to be a blind person. My eyes are dysfunctional or non-functional. So this dysfunctional or non-functional eyes are divine. And those of you who can see, your eyes are non-divine. How ridiculous it is. You may recall that earlier on when this term Harijan, which was used with the best of intentions for our so-called Dalit brothers and sisters, was used for some time, but when education and awareness grew amongst the so-called Dalit brothers and sisters, their leaders objected to the use of this word Harijan, and they said, Harijan, if we are Harijan, everybody is Harijan. Harijan means God's children. So it's not just that only Dalits are God's children. If the only Dalits are God's children, whose children are the non-Dalits? Are we children of devil? No. So, and again, I'm telling you, the use of the word Divyang is very condescending and patronizing. It's like a non-disabled person suggesting that, well, we are very well aware of your helplessness, but we are so great that we do not keep on reminding you about it, and therefore we are imparting you dignity. You do not impart dignity by this word. You impart dignity when you actually recognize our abilities and our potential in practice. That's where. And then if you say that I have divine abilities, then where is the need for Department of Empowerment of Persons with Disabilities? So this is about it. Then I come to the discrimination on ground of disability. Disability does not figure in Article 15 as a prohibited ground of discrimination. Now, Article 15(1) is not about any is not restricted or limited only to accessing some places. For that, Article 15(2), subclause 2 is additionally there. It is an addition. So therefore, it is misleading to suggest that it is only for access. No, it is not only for access as is sought to be made out. It is not only for, it cannot be. So this is one thing. Secondly, if Article 14 is there and you are saying that so it doesn't matter, then why did Article 15 matter? And do you think that persons with disabilities have no problems in accessing? Yes. In some places, persons with disabilities are unfortunately considered as inauspicious. So places of worship, places of wells, what prevented or what prevents the government even now from including this word, including disability as a prohibited ground of acts, of discrimination? So I feel that it is not right to suggest it doesn't matter. It does matter. And I think we as persons with disabilities, we as primary stakeholders, we as, a part of vibrant civil society must keep this demand alive. And I think it is doing a disservice to say, in a way, to suggest directly or indirectly that we don't need that. And then about the consultation thing. Yes, I do agree that wide-ranging consultations were conducted by the government. In fact, I would go so far as to say that my sense is, and I'm subject to correction, after the Right to Information Act, perhaps the Rights of Persons with Disabilities Act is one of the very few acts where very large-scale consultations were held. I think consultations were held in as many as 19 or maybe 20 or 22 places, and persons with disabilities actively participated in it. So that is fine. But I think the committee, what the committee meant was not only about the act. The committee probably meant that you need to involve different groups of persons with disabilities, including women with disabilities, children with disabilities, at various levels, at the monitoring level, at the impact assessment level. This is what probably the committee meant, and that's what I feel. So therefore, it's very important that, persons with disabilities have to be more actively consulted and involved, particularly in respect of matters that affect their lives as persons with disabilities. Friends, I feel that this gives you some idea of what transpired. But yes, I must acknowledge that Mr. Santosh Rungta was a part of the official delegation. And a part of the official delegation that he was, he probably felt a little tied to an unspoken protocol. I do understand that to some extent, but I feel that the statement could have been made with greater tact and skill. One could, for example, have said that yes, Article 15 should have disability as a prohibited ground of discrimination. For now, it doesn't exist, though Article 14 is there, but we do hope that in course of time, maybe the government would like to take a look at it, and rather than going into this access business and going out of way to justify certain things which are actually not justifiable in my opinion. And then with regard to the word Divyang, maybe he could have said, there are divergent opinions on it, and maybe things are evolving, something of that sort. could have been said rather than, you know, trying to justify. Yes, it could have been stated that the intent is good. And that's where even I don't have any disagreement. The intention is good. But words do matter. Terminology does matter. Some good words, you feel good. Some other kinds of word, maybe some words may irritate you. Some word may feel you may make you feel sad. Some other terminology may make you feel happy. But whatever terminology you use, it should be based on sense. It should be based on, the foundation should be that of equality and dignity. So that's how I feel. Divyang, of course, should not be there. Thankfully, the English translation of the R.P.D. Act is Rights of Persons with Disabilities Act. It's not Rights of Persons with Divine Limbs Act. Though the Hindi translation is, I think, the official Hindi translation is Divyang Jan Adhikar Adhiniyam. Since this is the official translation, we may have to keep saying this for a while, but I actually don't endorse this. So I think gives my perspective on it. Reflect on this. Thank you.
Speech on send button.